7 o'clock meeting for the appeal of the stop work order on Lake Adams demolition. Presentation by the plaintiff.
Thank you, Mayor. First, I'd like to say thanks for letting us have an opportunity to come before you today. This is to appeal a stop work order that was issued at the Lake Alice demolition site. You're probably all familiar with it. The purpose of the order was permit number 201-4201, and it was an alleged violation of the release of sediment from state waters and waters of the U.S. per the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. The stop work order has been provided to you in the materials that was submitted to you last week. I'm sorry, July 23rd, the FedEx. And we've provided some additional material that covers the issues I'd like to review today. Under the city ordinance, the inspector has the erosion control inspector the right to issue notices of violations, warnings, stop work orders. Stop work order is the most significant violation that they can find. And the stop work order requires two things. First, there has been a release of sediment in state waters. If there has been a release of sediment in state waters, whether the alleged discharge poses, and I'm quoting, imminent threat to public health and the waters of the state. So it's a two-pronged test. Was a release of sediment in state waters? And if there was it an imminent threat to public health and the waters of the state? And we submit that it's not going to happen. Not even close. On the date that Mr. Thompson came out of the property, he had conducted an inspection, and Dr. Wellington, Dr. Brian Wellington, is here to hear from him in a moment. Was present on site, was responsible for overseeing all of the work that's being done, consulting perspective. And he oversees our contractors as well. He was responsible for designing the plan, demolition plan that was going on out there. And he was also responsible for designing the ultimate leader structure that's going to be going in place. The whole purpose of his being out there was to collect geotechnical data in order to further define what that group will like and how it's going to work. Secondary to that is also to lay back the size of the dam. If you can imagine the dam reach that was looking like this, so the area has been blown out. It has been eroded. So what's happening these areas as winds are starting to fall in. And as you know, the city of Cumming and Ashburn family entered into a consent order. This is one of the things that we have to address. So the two purposes were, number one, to get the technical, and number two, deal with this collapsing or flooding in the lands. With that, I'd like to call Dr. Welling to come up. There's a question about that.
Call him, I'd like to address him.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, sir.
You were talking about collecting technical data. What technical data are you talking about?
So in order for the weir design, the weir is basically work of all. Have to understand whether what's underneath the wall, how we design the wall so that it stands up. You don't want them falling over. You can imagine it's going to be a lot of water pressure behind it. So going in with a geotechnical data, that is the quality of the soils and the rock underneath the wall, you design what that wall should look like, how the foundation should look like.
Okay. Mr. Mayor, members of the council, I'd like to make a motion to dismiss the appeal grounds that is untimely under section 113-49 of the City of Cummings Code, which provides it was adopted by the City Council in March 19, 2013, provides under 113-49 subsection A, E, and I'm reading part of it. Any appeal must be filed by an agreed party within 5 business days from the date of the action. Complaint of by filing with the zoning administrator or his designated at his office in City Hall, a notice of appeal specifying the ground number 4. There's no question in this case that the soccer order was issued on June the 24th of 2014. Not counting that day, 5 business days from that would be July 1. There's also no question that this appeal was filed in July 24th. So it was filed 23 days too late. Therefore, it's not in procedural accordance with the, they certainly have the right to appeal, they just can do so timely. Therefore, it is subject to being dismissed at this time. I respectfully move that the Board of Zoning Appeals dismiss the appeal. I'll provide a copy of that ordinance to the proposed
appeal. If I may respond, objections were made at the time that the appeal that the top report was issued. It was brought to the attention of the people that Thompson and also Mr. Morgan was aware of the position. We needed to collect the information that required to prove that what Mr. Thompson says he saw out there did not happen. That is the evidence that we put before this tribunal, and that's what we expect to show you today. What Mr. Thompson saw simply could not have happened. Notice was given promptly. As a matter of fact, Dr. Welling was given the opportunity to testify that he asked what the problem was. Initially, he was told he was not going to go into, he was not going to be advised as to what the issues were. Later, it was pointed out to him where there were some other violations. Notice was given. We can debate whether it was adequate notice, but I don't think it was.
Well, the code says that it has to be filed. There's no filing that happens until July 24th.
In other words, request was 23 days late, as you said.
Yes, sir. Didn't comply with the ordinance.
Okay. I recommend to the board that we take your motion to dismiss under advisement. I don't know what's going on, and I'm sure the board knows probably less than that, too. So I'd like to hear what's going on. So I'd just like to take it under advisement and hear the case.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Proceed.
My phone. You raise your right hand, please. You swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give through the whole truth about the piece that I've got.
Aye.
Please state your name for the record.
My name is Brian Wilmington.
Where are you employed?
I'm employed by New Fields Engineering.
In what capacity are you employed?
I'm a senior engineer at New Fields.
Can you tell body what your education is like for you?
I have an undergraduate degree in civil engineering. A master's degree in water resources engineering and a PhD in civil and environmental engineering.
You hold any professional licenses and certifications?
Yes, I'm a licensed engineer in the state of Georgia, and I'm also certified for design of buildings and control in Georgia.
What is your area of expertise specifically?
My expertise is stormwater hydrology, design of erosion control measures.
You ever testified as an expert before?
Yes, I have.
In those specific areas that you're just doing?
Yes, I have.
Has any court ever not accepted your testimony?
No.
When do you retain the connection to Lake Allison?
I was retained towards the May 2013, around when the Lake Allison reached.
And for what purpose were you retained?
I was retained to come up with a remediation plan for the lake and also to investigate what caused the breach of the dam.
Most recently, what was the purpose of your report at Lake Allison?
The purpose of the work was to come with a design for the remediation plan. Prior to doing discussions, the city of Cumming had come up with a plan that we thought could not protect the clean air. It would result in more sedimentation to the clean air. So we came up with a different plan that would involve construction of a weir structure across the old dam bridge location, which we believe would provide better protection for the clean air.
So to clarify, did the city prepare an initial plan?
Yes, they did.
And review that plan?
Yes, they did.
And did you make any conclusions regarding whether that plan would be effective in stopping continuing sedimentation of lake?
Yes, I did make that determination.
And was it an effective plan that the city submitted?
No, it was not.
What did you do in response to that?
I thought we had my own plan. I had my own plan.
Was that plan ultimately approved by the Environmental Protection Division?
Yes, the Georgia EPD, we submitted conceptual plans to the EPD and the Army Corps engineers. They reviewed it, they accepted it, and we're now in the process of with the final designs.
You obtained all the necessary land disturbance permits that were required in the city?
Yes, we did.
During the course of your work on the property, can you tell the body what the purpose of your work was in the main time period?
Yeah, what we were hoping to do was, what we did was, we wanted to A, have access to the site to do geological investigations, which is basically going in and taking out some of the underlying rock below the old dam location so that we could design the river structure.
During the period of time that you were out there, was that over many weeks?
Yes, we were there for about 2 weeks.
Okay. And did the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, the EPD, and the EPA come out to inspect the site?
Yes, they did come out on numerous occasions.
Other than the stop work order we're discussing here, did any of those other regulatory agencies ever tell you that there was a violation that was ongoing, identify a violation that needed to be corrected?
No, they did not.
Tell us, were you present on the site on June 24th?
Yes, I was.
And that was the date the stop work order was issued?
That is correct.
Tell us what happened.
I was at the site, and the site is two sections. There's the northern section and the southern section. I was in the southern section with the construction crew, and this is Tom came to the site. He was in the northern section. I noticed he was on the site, but he was far away from the crew at that point. He left the site, he came back later on, and issued the stop work order.
And the stop work order?
Yes, indeed.
And what did he tell you?
He told me that he was stopping and working on the site because there had been a discharge taken into the stream.
And did you respond or object to that direction?
I responded by saying that there has not been any discharge and the police have been trying to revert the discharge on the other side and enter the downstream.
And what did Mr. Thompson tell you?
Initially, he said that he did not have to tell me where something that entered the stream. In fact, he said he thought I was trying to argue with him, and I was just trying to figure out why he wouldn't stop.
And did he ultimately show you areas that he thought there was an alleged violation occurring?
Yes, sir.
Okay, did you go over and inspect that with him personally?
Yes, I did.
What did you see?
Well, he took, the area he took me to was the there's an old school, it's still over the old dam. He took me down to that location. He said to me, this is where the sediments came in. He said that the sediments had collapsed in the sediments in the stream channel. And he showed me where he said the sediments had entered.
Did you observe what you described as sediments that were entering the stream channel?
I observed sediments in the stream channel, but they were not sediments that had come from outside.
And how is it you were able to make that determination?
Well, the location where he took me to, the sediments in the stream channel were gray in color. And when we were working at the dam had been built with red clay. So what we were excavating was red clay. So our site was all red clay. So if our site had been shot sediments into the stream channel, we would see red clay, which would be said sediments in that not gray sands.
Were you responsible for designing and installing the containment estimating practices that were implemented at the site?
Yes, I was.
At any time during the period of work that was going on out there, was there ever any failure of any best management practice?
No, there was not.
At some point, did you inform Mr. Thompson that you disagreed with his assessment that there had been a discharge?
Yes, I did.
And what did you do next?
Well, after that, I was there with the contractor and was trying to figure out what he wanted us to do to stop up order, and he told us what he wanted. And so we proceeded to try to install the things that he thought were necessary.
Did you believe that those were necessary?
No.
After that that occurred, did you do any testing out there on the stream channel to determine whether or not there was in fact a discharge?
Yes, in fact, on the very day that he issued the stop order, we went out and tested the stream channel at various locations. We tested upstream of our excavation area, downstream of our area, and we also tested close to where he said the sediment had entered the stream channel.
I'm going to direct you to the document that's been provided for the cover letters. It's appeal to stop work order of Lake House and under specific coming or the zone of appeals hearing August 19th, 2014. Is this a document that you assembled?
Yes, I did.
Okay, it contains a number of photographs. Those photographs were provided by both Mr. Thompson and by yourself.
That is correct.
Okay. The last page of the document shows streams of stream turbidity in the top of it. Can you explain to this board very briefly what that is?
I'm not sure if you guys are familiar with this, but the image that you're looking at is in this portion right here. It's where the ground can be used. And this is the section of the world. Now, these are blue stars on the drawing at the location where we took several samples. So this is an excavation area right here. We took two samples upstream of the excavation area, and we also took three samples downstream of the excavation area.
What are those? And those samples were taken the day of the stop work order was issued, correct?
Yes. We took samples on three different days. On the first day we took a sample was immediately after the order had been issued. We also took another sample on the 30th. On that day we had some rain, and so normally what happens is when it rains, that is when water that segments are flushed into a stream channel. We took samples on that day as well, and we also took samples on the 19th of July, which we had
in each case, what do those samples show?
Well, the first sample we took on the 24th, the day this double order was issued, shows that on average, the turbidity in the stream channel was about 11 MTUs, which is just a measurement of turbidity that we used. And it was 11 going all the way from upstream of our site all the way down to where he said there was a discharge of sediments. And what this shows is that there could not have been a condition from our site, but if there was, then the downstream location would show a higher amount of entity than the upstream section.
And on each of the three occasions, the sample and the analytical sampling that you obtained did or did not show an increase in turbidity downstream?
It would not show up as a minor increase.
Okay, so even if there was a minor increase, would that have been within the 25 increase limit that's provided for under the ordinance?
Exactly. The ordinance says that when you sample upstream and downstream on the site, and it's supposed to be discharging sediments into the stream channel, the different between the upper measurement and the downer measurement must not be more than 25 MTUs. If it's more than 25, that implies that we have had some discharge. And none of our samples show an increase anywhere close to 25.
Was there any evidence in the photos that were provided by Mr. Thompson? Did Mr. Thompson give you copies of his photos at the time?
No, he did not.
And when did you ultimately receive those photos?
Mr. Thompson sent the photographs to Mr. Tony Campbell of the Georgia EPD, and Mr. Campbell forwarded the photographs to me.
Do you recall when that was?
I'm not sure of the exact date, but I believe it was the week that he came out to the site.
Does that mean a week after the stop work order was issued?
Yes.
Did you make any determination based on the analytical data that had been discharged and set into the stream generally as a result of what Mr. Thompson identified was a best management practice, a BMP violation?
Yes, I did make a determination.
What is that determination?
That based on our measurements and the photographs that he provided, there could not have been a discharge on our side.
In your professional opinion, is there any imminent threat to public health or waters of the state based on the evidence that you mapped for you?
No, there's no evidence.
Have you reviewed the ordinance for stormwater erosion in City of Cumming?
Yes, I have.
Is there a violation of that ordinance?
No, there's no violation.
That is confirmed by both the lab data and the photographs?
And even by the test data and the photographs.
And your observations?
Okay. Yes.
Based on your training, experience, knowledge of this particular site and otherwise, your professional opinion, is there any basis for that stop work order to be issued?
No, there was not.
Did the management incur any additional costs as a result of the stop work order?
Yes, they did.
Okay. With regard to, are you familiar with those costs?
Yes, I am.
Okay. Those are costs that you received from the contractor from your own company?
That is correct.
What is the amount of costs that the stop work order cost the management family?
In totality, from both the contractor and usually for my company, it's about $25,000.
I have in the record that's already been provided $17,172.14 for the contractor and $6,974 for your firm.
That sounds good.
Did you have an opportunity to speak with Mr. Morgan about lifting the stop work order?
I did not speak to him directly about the stop work order. My representative on site.
Mr. Cluzio reports to you.
Yes, yes.
He's in your charge and you have confidence in his ability.
Yes, I do.
And what was reported to you?
Well, Mr. Cluzio told me that only the inspector that had issued the stop work order would lift it. So we had to wait until Mr. Thompson took the stop work order.
So you had informed Mr. Thompson that you disagreed with his opinion the day that the stop work order was issued, you gave notice of that?
Yes, I did.
Okay. And then you also received, informed Mr. Morgan that there was a disagreed with the stop work order being issued?
I believe Mr. DeLuzio told me that.
And then Mr. DeLuzio implemented some additional DMPs that were demanded by the city?
That is correct.
And then they refused to release the stop work order until Mr. Thompson returned back from vacation a month ago.
That is correct, yes.
Just to confirm your opinions, Dr. Wellington, there was no loss of sediment to the stream as a result of the stop work order and disturbing activities?
There was no disturbing sediment.
And there was no imminent threat to the environment or the stream by the way disturbing activities conducted?
That is correct, yes.
And all BMPs were properly designed, installed, and maintained at all times?
That is correct, yes.
Ask a few questions. Dr. Wellington, just a couple of follow-ups. Is this stream turbidity that's in the last page that you put together?
Yes.
Do you have any readings at all for June the 23rd, 2014? Isn't that correct?
No, no.
And isn't that the day when rain occurred?
Yes, but
But
Mr. Thompson issued the report on the 24th. That's when he came out of the
right, and if he observed it and discharged it, I'm going to ask you about that in just a second. On the 24th, wouldn't necessarily show up in turbidity readings from the day before it already come through. Every one of your turbidity readings is higher than those ranges, correct?
If you look at the
take a look at the first one. Yeah. There's no rain. That's 8.61.
Yes.
Then you got 0.2 inches of rain. 26.07. Isn't that higher than 8.61?
Yes.
Okay. And then the next day, let me finish my question. Then you can answer. On July 19th, you got 1.74. It's 118 NTUs. Isn't that a higher number than 26 and 8?
Yes. Now, what you're doing, you're looking at 1 point. You're looking at option point.
But isn't that true across the board? And every one of these doesn't go up when there's rain.
That is my answer.
Does it go up? That's my question.
It goes up at every point, every time it rains. However, if you look at the numbers, when you move from the upstream end to the downstream end, the upstream end is either way higher than the downstream end or there's very little change between the upstream and the downstream end.
So let's look at the last two.
Yeah.
On 624, the turbidity is 11.47, and then further downstream, 12.57. Isn't 12.57 higher than 11.47?
Yes, that is based on the instrument error. And also, look at the standard is.
So your instrument has errors?
Every instrument that you use in any discipline has an accuracy, a plus or minus. Now, let me introduce you. The standard is that the input should be 25 NTUs. 12.54 minus 12.54 minus 12.57 minus 11.47. That is less than 1 inch of the difference, which is less than which is within the error range. So the accuracy of the instrument error is
equal. You testified earlier that you had prepared design and supervise the installation of all of the BMPs on the property, correct?
That's right, yes.
Okay, now I'm going to show you a photograph that I previously provided council. All of them have a number at the top. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I'm going to show you photograph number one. Okay, are there any BMPs in that photograph?
Now, where exactly is this?
This is on your site. You're not familiar with that?
This is the road. See this? The road there. I'm not sure what this is. I'm not sure this is what we have carried out. But as you know,
no BMP thing.
Hold on. As you know, when you go on the site initially, you start playing with the site in 4 years old and hundreds of BMPs without playing the site. And this was not on the day that we had the Mr. Fonty next step work this job.
There's no BMPs. Okay, so you don't think that was over there? Now, you also said that none of the BMPs that you installed failed.
That's right.
Okay, I'm going to show you number two. You or the companies you work with installed the hay bales along the edge of the creek at the high water mark, didn't you?
That's right.
They were staked at what you thought was the high water mark along the edge of the creek, correct?
And that was what we thought, and also what
Now, you see in picture number two, there's a hay bale in the middle of the creek. See that?
I see that, yes.
Okay, but that's not a failure, right?
The BMPs that we designed for the site are shown on this picture.
That's not my question. You said you installed that, and I asked you if it failed. Did it fail or not fail?
Can I answer your question?
Yes. Yes or no, please. Did it fail or not fail?
That's not the answer to the question.
No. My question is, you installed the BMPs, you said yes. I said, there's a hay bale in the middle of the creek. You said yes. I said, isn't that a failure? And you haven't answered that. Can you answer that for me?
I'll give the answer.
No, answer my question, sir. Did it fail or not? Yes or no? Very simple.
The hay bales are not BMPs that we installed as part of our work.
Oh, so you did install
it. The hay bales were installed because when we started the installation, because of the shape of the it was impossible to go into the transition. So we put the hay bales on the edge of the stream now, protected from any fallback from the accelerator. After we finished that process, it was done in the stream, then we installed the vertical mass. Now,
But on the 23rd and the 24th, the erosion control maps were not installed, correct?
That is incorrect. They were pre-installed. If you look at the document we provided, if you go to page, the base of the page, this is the following. This is the site. So you have dates on the 23rd. This is the site completely part of the erosion control maps. But which way did at the end to design the site, design for the site?
Okay, so if you didn't design the straw bales, you didn't install the straw bales.
If you go to the second picture.
Sir, I'm not asking you about the second. I'm asking you about these pictures. Number three. Seen this?
I've seen it.
Okay, is that a hay bale?
That is a hay bale.
And is it where it was originally put?
No, it's not where it was.
Okay, and is there a hay bale that used to be where that stick is in the middle of the picture?
Yes.
That's the third stick, the hay bale, right?
That's right.
Hay bale's not there anymore.
Well, I hope you know that hay bales are not secondaries. And we're talking about secondaries, which my hay bales need to be tied.
Exhibit number four, photograph number four,
yes.
That show hay bales in the middle of the creek.
Yes.
Now, the hay bales didn't just leap up out of their own accord and leave the state and jump into the middle of the creek, correct, Doctor?
That's right.
They were washed in there by water or by sediment or by some force,
yes.
Correct?
But
do you know what washed them in?
You have said that the hay bales were installed. I don't know if I was wrong.
Oh, you said that. I asked you.
You asked me if that, and I said yes. I remember that. We did not excavate. We didn't have a lot of marsh. Because it was uncollected around that. That was my question. So those are put in a location that had nothing to do with excavation. So if they washed away, that is really the thing. So it means that they washed away. Because it was in the time.
You said that you could tell that there was no sediment in the creek because of the color. Is that correct?
That's right.
And is it your testimony that there is no change and there was no gray, it was all red?
From the solution?
Yes.
So yes, it was actually red. Isn't
it true that you filed no appeal for the stop work order in this case that was filed by the attorneys for the management? Correct?
That's right.
You didn't file anything with Mr. Morgan on or Thompson at any point in time related to the stop work order?
I made a little bit of a list of Mr. Thompson.
Asked him to deliver the stop work
order? Yeah,
not
I,
put in voice.
I told him that I don't believe that there was any strike on the side.
Yeah. Thank you.
Those elevations, we remove them before you see installing the sequences and the explanation. Slowly.
Thank you for the clarification. Turning to your stream turbidity chart, in each one of those sampling events, was there a violation of the erosion and sediment control ordinance here at the city of Cumming?
No.
That information is reflected, that opinion is reflected in the data that we take, is that correct?
That's right. The code is that upstream end and downstream end. Downstream should be higher than the upstream end by at least 25 MTUs. There is nowhere on this code that shows anywhere close to 25.
Now, Mr. Miles asked you whether 118.67 is a bigger number than 8.61. And I think we would stipulate that it is a bigger number.
It is a bigger number.
Does that mean that the sediment is coming down from its sources above the areas that you were testing and migrating through? Is that what that data reflects?
The first thing is the mass was looking at a single location on three different lanes. When it was 8.6, there was no rain. When it was 118.67, there was rain. And it was the option end. So that reflects sediment coming from our site. Not from our side.
Thank you. No further questions.
My comments, Thompson. And that's what the council just said. You're using your rebuttal time. Let me back up. Happy to be here. Question, Mr. Thompson?
Thank you.
Right hand, please. So I'm sure that you're about to give them back out in the court of the Supreme Court of Pugh. Truth, all truth, nothing. Truth, self, God. Mr. Thompson, could you tell the board, please, what position you're in with the city of Cumming?
I am the chief of the division for the city of Cumming.
And how long have you held that title?
Approximately 6 years.
Did you have occasion to visit the site of the Stockport Court in June of this year?
I did.
What data was first?
Any time of significant rain, I always try to make a point to go out and look at job sites that have open ground that are in the midst of land disturbing activity. That is what I did on this particular day. We have had rains starting about 4:30 on the 23rd.
What day is it?
The 23rd, that would have been Monday, I believe. It rained on through the night, and so the next morning, I not only checked this site, but another site that we had that was open, and I think that's where I disturbed the plan. When I first drove into this property, I saw that a good amount of mud had been cracked out onto Sanders Road. When this initially started, there was a good roadway into this area because the road had been there for years and years. I did not at that time require a construction entrance because the road was in good shape. As traffic went back and forth, it deteriorated. Heavy equipment went back and forth. And it deteriorated to a point where sediment and all that got out onto the roadway. I drove on into the property. I noticed an area where they had stockpiled all the dirt that they pulled out from the stream bank where they had sloped it back. Stockpile had pretty much been left. And so didn't have any silt fence around it, any kind of, anything to establish it to keep it from eroding in any way. Now, let me hasten to say, I would not have place to stop work order on job for construction entrance. So I would discuss with them and put it in. Nor would I have for the stockpile because it had not exceeded the 14-day period. Now, we did discuss those things and talked about them, and they did eventually fix them after our discussion. But those were not the reasons for stop work order. As I went on into the property, I got out of my vehicle. Dr. Wells and some other gentlemen were on the southern abutment of the creek. I was on the northern side. I went ahead and conducted my inspection. If you will, please, in the packet that has been provided, Number one, this is a roadway that has been put in by another contractor that actually went down to the mill house. The mill house was disassembled and saved and carried to another location. However, the contractor that was out there working continued to use this roadway. And in the continued use of this roadway, it continued to afford to deteriorate. And no efforts were made to do anything with this roadway as far as getting it established to keep it from eroding. There was no silt fence around it on the sides, nor at what you might consider the total slope. And it had an open area that went right into where the mill house had been and could dump right into the creek. On photo two, you begin to see some of the hay bales have been washed away. Prior to this event, there was a meeting out there with the U.S. Corps of Engineers, Georgia DPD, myself, and Scott Morgan, along with Dr. Wellington, and I believe a gentleman with American Environmental. We discussed what was going to take place. The BMPs were not complete at that time. And we all shared concern about the continuing erosion of that bank. They had begun to put in some of these hay bales, and we questioned both myself and the DPD, questioned Jeff Bishop, the DPD, questioned us whether or not they felt like this would hold in the event of substantial rain. They said they felt like it would, that it would do the job, and nothing else would need to take place. If you look at photo number three, again, that is where most of the hay bales have been washed away. You can see the stake sitting there that has just been left where the hay bales have been washed on downstream. Photo four, this is approximately, I would say, 75 to 80 feet from where the hay bales were located. It was washed that far, these two were. If you look at photo number five, there was some debris from where the dam had breached. These hay bales here were probably about 150 feet from where the work had taken place. So significant water pushing all these hay bales downstream. It stands to reason that if the hay bales are gone and no longer providing protection, that there's erosion taking place as well. Now, the statement was made that there was no imminent threat. Well, I beg to differ. We are talking about this discharging into a cove that has already been compromised due to the breach of the dam. And the cove exists in Lake Honea, and we all know that it's used for people to draw water and used for municipalities and everything. So I would contend that it is a little more important than what has been let on. On page six, you'll see a picture of some failed silt fence. The argument and contention that was given to me the day that I inspected this and we walked this with them, or I walked this with them, was that this was not their silt fence, that they did not install. Well, not only did they continue to use the roadway, therefore becoming responsible for establishing that roadway and protecting it because they used it and continued to erode it away, they filled in where a spillway had been at the old mill house. And this was at the foot of that spillway. So this is an area that they had impact upon. So yes, they were responsible for maintaining B&Bs in that area because they affected that area by filling in the spillway. If you would please look at picture number seven, showing where all the hay bales pretty much have been washed away. You've got just a bare addressed this two different times. You will see the lighter sediment in there on this sandbar. It is my contention that this came from that rain event, that it continued to erode away. Now, they made a point of saying that there was no gray mud to come down, that everything there was red. If you'll look at photo number 10, this was taken about 2 or 3 weeks before any work began at all. And I took this picture for one reason. It shows a layer of gray soil at the base of that slope, right at the water line. So it would be no surprise to me that there would be gray sediment being washed down when it is on that bank. That picture clearly shows. And there was other opportunities. I could have taken more pictures, but you can see layers all in there of alternating red clay and this gray dirt. So I contend that in picture number 8, that could be fresh sediment, because there does exist gray dirt within the bank where this continued to erode. And photo number 9 just simply is where I took a picture of my footsteps the day that I went out there after the rain event, where fresh sediment had washed in. And it was just very, very wet. And then I'll direct you to my spot work order, which states none of the other things that we eventually talked about and were eventually fixed. The purpose of the stop work order was release of sediment in the state waters and waters of the U.S. per the Corps of Engineers determination. I did, as they say, was out there. I left. I did not engage in conversation at that time. My purpose was that I wanted to come back to the office, make Scott Morgan, my supervisor, aware of the fact that I felt like there had been a significant release of sediment into state waters, and of my intention to issue a state work, stop work order. I also called the EPD, and I spoke to Tony Campbell. I also informed him, and he agreed and said that, you know, we probably needed to go ahead and get some of these issues addressed and taken care of, because everybody expressed concerns about that bank on that meeting several days prior to this rain event. I think it was on the 19th. And again, they were asked several times whether or not this would be sufficient. As we see in this photo, it was not. Another reason for the spot work order would be was that there was areas that was outside the bounds of the plan that they were responsible for, that they took no effort to try to protect, that being that roadbed and the spillway. So based on all that, and the fact that it did flow into Lake Honea and a code that was already compromised, is why I issued the stop order.
Why does the lack of turbidity readings on the 23rd and the rain event happen? Why is that important?
Well, he's showing on the 24th a 0-inch rain event. Well, the rain occurred on the 23rd. That's why I was out there on the 24th. So that, to me, really says nothing.
Subsequent to the stop work order being issued, did the Mashburn Trust install BMPs in order to get the stop work order lifted? Did they do something after the 24th? In order to encourage you or to allow you to lift the stop work order?
Was out of the office post 24th till the following Monday, which was the 30th. So the 30th was the first opportunity I had to get back out there. When I got back out there, I inspected, I looked at it. They had satisfied what I had asked them to do, everything had been taken care of. Not only in the fashion that I expected, but in some areas exceeding, and so therefore I had to stop working.
I have any further questions about this?
Thank you, Mr. Austin.
I'm gonna go, slower, because I really want to go into some questions. You're familiar with, and does the ordinance here in the city of Cumming require method or MTU testing to be done in front of whether there are any impacts or diseases related?
It does, yes.
And the analytical data that's obtained by Dr. Wellington, that data show any increase above what is permitted under the city ordinance?
Well, again, I will point to the fact that the first reading we have here is on the 24th. And he is showing 0 inches of rain. We're not talking about the 24th, we're talking about the 23rd. And as the pictures show, evidently there was quite substantial rain in order for all of those hay bales to wind up, one of them even all the way down to the cove there, Blackburn near Sanders Road.
You weren't on site on the 23rd, were you?
No, I was not.
You were on site on the 24th?
Yes.
Your observations were based on what you saw on the 24th, correct?
They were. However, I was very aware of the fact that it had rained substantially the night before.
I understand. But as to your observations that you made, with effluentric turbidity testing, MTU testing done on the 24th, does not reflect a violation in the area that you identified, does it? Let me ask the question again. Upstream, you see that yellow X?
I do.
Is that the area that you identified as sediment at? Is the source of sediment upstream now?
It is.
Okay. Upstream, there was some sampling that was done, and downstream, does that show an increase in more than 25 NTUs?
It does not. It also shows 0 inches of rain. It would not be the case.
I'm with you. But there's still water moving through stream.
All right.
Okay. So that water would have erosion of that, right?
Streams are always in floods.
And you would have observed sediment in the stream channel, correct?
I did observe sediment in the stream channel.
In fact,
I have been out there on numerous occasions, and I have watched these sandbars grow. And I saw some areas of growth in the sandbars from the time that we were there on the 19th to the 24th.
In fact, there's a lot of sedimentation going on in that watershed. That's a continuing problem.
Well, the upstream has been established for some time. After the dam bridge, the city went in there, and we got established with grassing and matting and everything, trying to bring it back and establish it. There are some developments upstream. I've been watching and monitoring them very closely. I will be honest with you, find out easy enough. I have placed my work orders on them, but it has not been for discharge into upstream.
So it's your sworn testimony here today, that makes sense. It's your sworn testimony here today that the late bottom sediments and what was the house are not causing any sedimentation in the downstream of the testimony?
During any rain event, okay, any stream will become turbid. The question is to what degree? Alright? And to what degree that land disturbance is adding to it above and beyond. That is why you do your monitoring and sampling ahead and below.
Just like Dr. Wellington.
That gives you a view of what's going on.
Just like Dr. Wellington.
Post 24th, yes.
Okay. 24th, and on the 30th, and on the 19th afterward.
I would like to have seen a reading for the 23rd.
We weren't out there either on the 23rd. Take that, maybe we have inside. Let me ask you this. How much sediment has been moved into Lake Clear? Y'all have done some sediment studies out there.
I don't know the exact volumes. I don't know what the calculations were.
Tens of thousands of cubic yards.
Maybe you'd ask him.
Feet of sediment. Correct?
I'm sure.
Okay. And the dam reach area was unsafe, correct? The reach zone?
Prior to?
Prior to work with Dr. Wellington and his team doing it. That was an unsafe breach zone, correct? Okay. In fact, the city of Cumming and my clients are both being sued. If another entity and accused of causing that reef zone to continue to allow sediment to go downstream, correct? And the city is defendant in that case, correct?
Correct.
Just like the Mashburn family is related to that, correct?
Correct.
And the Mashburn family has actually filed cross claim against the city, where that?
I'm all in your little far field in the Stockport Court, I ask you to please focus your thinking on that.
Just wanted to understand what he was aware of when he went down there and did his inspection.
If you're trying to say that that would have any bearing on my decision on that day, it would not. I think anybody that I have dealt with in the past would not have anything to say about me at that time. Across the board, I don't treat anybody any different in any way. I try to have a standard for them to want.
These photographs that you've taken, no dates on those photographs, are they?
They're not dated, but you have my sworn testimony that one in 24.
Every one of these
photographs? With the exception of the number 10 here, which was about 3 weeks prior. As you can see, none of the work had been done, but that's still straight back.
Okay, and you talked about the root structure down, the organic material, that's right?
Right.
Are hay bales a threat, any threat to the environment?
My concern was not with the hay bales, but with sediment loss.
Seems to be a big concern with Mr. Miles as he's processing.
Well, the reason being, if you have enough water and pushes what you have put there to protect away, you have had a failure of your BMP. Therefore, it has allowed sediment to enter in to an area where you have tried to protect it and it failed.
In fact, that's an assumption of your part. You see that?
It is my determination based on my credentials. I hold a red card and both gray card, both soil and water. I've had extensive training in that. And it was my estimation that there had been significant loss in that area. It has since been agreed upon with members of the EPD as well, because they were out there on numerous occasions and were able to witness this as well.
Do you have correspondence from the documentation and violations by EPD or Georgia Soil Water Conservation Service or the Board of Engineers and my client?
I can tell you this, that the EPA is now involved and is pursuing the issue and having a desire to pursue it and see, you know, what needs to be done, what actually needs to be taken.
Back to my question. Do you have evidence that any notices of violation or stop work orders or any other type of violation is an issue by the Army Corps of Engineers, EPD, or the EPA, that's my client, as a result of what you saw?
I cannot speak for the Corps of Engineers. I can speak for EPD. EPD is a state entity. We are licensed, and you know, a license or licensing issuing authority under the authority of the EPD. As long as they are comfortable that the city of Cumming is handling the situation and taking care of it and doing what needs to be done, they will not get involved. That is their stance. If they feel like we are not doing our job, they will then step in.
The NTU sampling that was provided, the analytical data was provided, that doesn't show any violation, does it? Yes,
again, it does not, but I would say that's a moot point because it does not show the rain event that we're talking about.
It shows multiple rain events after, does it?
After, yes.
Mayor, I believe that completes the appeal from both sides.
Concludes both sides. No summation for the side. Let's see. Okay. Well, I didn't hear any evidence where EPD or EPA had been. Mr. Weatherman's statements and comments in reference to what appeared to be an egregious violation of these various pictures of land that I've ever seen. I didn't hear
here where EPD or EPA have been contacted to come and review stuff. Also, I think it was justified, by looking at these pictures, that stop work order was relevant to the site. And I would recommend the board that hundreds of evidence that's been presented by the city, and we see hay bales, and Mr. Cabela, you're exactly right, they don't pose a threat, an environmental problem to the water, but due to the fact that that was the big gate that let all the siltation and the red clay and everything infiltrate into the stream, I think y'all would certainly in violation of the Clean Water Act. So I'd recommend to the council that we deny your request and rule in favor of the city. Chair, I entertain a motion.
The motion that I made, I think y'all have heard the merits. The motion I made was to dismiss the appeal on the grounds that it didn't meet the 5 business day deadline, which would have expired on July 21 and filed on July 24.
Okay. But I want to hear all the evidence and everything. Okay, so let me see that, because I hadn't seen any of the first time I've heard Mr. Thompson, and it's the first time I've seen these pictures. This is enough for me from what I've seen.
From my experience, it is, you've got a deadline you've got to meet, and I make a motion
I have a second. I have a motion and a second. Any other discussion on this board? All in favor, signify by raising your hand. Unanimous. Thank you very much.
I think you'll pick it up.